This is a monster called Orlok. In 1922, the German makers of the film Nosferatu couldn't get copyright clearance for his real title, Count Dracula. But the first screen Dracula he was, one of the most famous monsters who never lived.
Good evening. I'm Charles Osgood. This eerie and forbidding place is one of the symbols of Dracula's continuing success story. This is not his home in Transylvania. This is his American headquarters in Hollywood, California. Here he has another castle and another casket. But here he bites by day, frightening and entertaining the thousands of people who come to see this monster live as part of the famous Universal Studios tour. You might say Universal has a big stake in Dracula. At one time or another, most of us have been fascinated or scared by monsters.
Monsters, those ugly, threatening, mysterious, powerful, sinister creatures who appear in every different shape and form our wildest imaginations can conceive.
Castle Dracula will be our CBS Monster Control. From here, we'll tune in many more movie monsters. We look for real-life monsters, too. So stay with us as we find out where monsters came from, what use they serve, what makes them tick, and why we keep them around to loathe and to love. There's a whole class of monsters which never have existed except in literature or on film. The monsters of the movies seem so real and are so much a part of our culture that they exist in our lives as truly as real places we've never been to and real people we've never met.
There is the classic monster in Beauty and the Beast. The story tells us that in this case, the monster's ugliness is only skin deep. Underneath, there is kindness and gentleness. And beneath the horrible Hyde hides a true prince.
Okay. Ibo. Mais je suis un monstre.
There he is. There's your man. I'm sorry, sir.
Continuing our thought about horrible Hydes, that's what Dr. Jekyll created out of himself when he took his own medicine and quickly dissolved into Mr. Hyde, his altered ego. Then there are the monsters created by mad scientists like Dr. Moreau. On his infamous island, his experiments have shown that the way to be truly cruel to an animal is to try to recast him as a human. Sometimes monsters are tiny things like insects, which have gotten out of control and have grown in size. Can you imagine the ants in them coming to your next picnic, but not to eat your food? And monsters are not only created on Earth. Some of them come from outer space. The Thing did. Beneath the Thing's incredible hulk was actor James Arness on his way to TV's Dodge City to become Marshal Matt Dillon. But in this film, it wasn't the smell of gun smoke that filled the air. And then there's the most famous movie monster of all. The monster of Dr. Frankenstein was a creature put together with parts gathered from dead human beings. But playing the monster wasn't a dead-end job for an English actor by the name of William Henry Pratt. Pratt, known on the screen as Boris Karloff, got $125 a week to carry around the 48-pound costume. The movie made both Karloff and Frankenstein's monster into stars.
Since the first Frankenstein movie was made in 1931, there have been no fewer than 28 movies featuring the monster. Some of the titles include Frankenstein Created Woman, Frankenstein's Son, The Bride of Frankenstein, I Was a Teenage Frankenstein, Frankenstein and the Monster from Hell, Frankenstein Meets the Space Monster, Abbott and Costello Meet Frankenstein, and what may be the ultimate spinoff, a title more monstrous than the movie itself, Jesse James Meets Frankenstein's Daughter.
Recently, amid his monster memorabilia, James Warren, the publisher of Famous Monsters magazine, shared with us some of his observations about the creatures of the cinema and gave us his definition of a monster.
A monster is a lead character in a movie in which the character generally assumes a form that is not human. The Lon Chaney Jr. who became a werewolf was a monster. Someone who can't control his emotions, someone who probably represents the forces of evil for the sake of the plot, someone who is vastly misunderstood by the people who are his victims. But most movie monsters in past history have been monsters who create havoc and destruction is rampant, and how do we kill this monster? Do we drop a bomb on him? Do we burn him? And do we recite poetry to him? I think the Phantom of the Opera, the classic Phantom of the Opera, was made into a so-called bad guy because he had acid thrown in his face when he found that they were stealing his music. In the early days, Frankenstein, the Wolfman, Dracula were considered villains. And back in the 1930s, when Universal Pictures came out with these movies, I was a kid. I was 8, 9, 10 years old. I would go into this huge movie theater, and totally black, and I would see on this big screen Frankenstein and the Wolfman and Dracula, and I was scared. And the monster was the villain. And we all cheered when the townspeople, carrying their torches, rid the town of this terrible villain. But what happened? It was very interesting. It was a complete turnaround in which a generation later, the youngsters embraced the monsters as the heroes, as misunderstood heroes, and it was the townspeople who were killing the monsters who were the bad guys. Totally different concept of villain and hero. King Kong scared my pants off when I first saw it, the original King Kong. But now I've come to love that jolly fellow, that huge monkey on the Empire State Building. And when he is shot by the airplanes and he falls, it brings tears to the eyes.
Isn't being frightened something that you try to avoid?
Normally, yes. But when you're watching a monster movie or when you're watching a TV show, it's something that you expect. It isn't like opening the door of your house and having someone come out and say boo to you, and that can scare you. When you're reading our material or watching monsters on radio, or not radio, but watching them on movies or television, you expect to be scared. It's similar to a roller coaster ride. That dip in the stomach that you get when you go down on that huge curve. The sense of being thrilled, exhilarated, the adrenaline pumps more. And if it's a temporary thing, as it is with monsters, I think it's not a bad thing.
Is there also a fascination in the morbid?
I think what's morbid is a Jack the Ripper concept of a man in London who preys on women victims and kills them. That's morbid. But a a creature from the Black Lagoon coming out from the swamp and invading the town, I don't think that's morbid at all. I think it's exciting.
Oh, we're clear. Stand by to pull her up with the winch. Pull her in.
Any monster you can name, there are exceptions, but almost anyone you can name, we have empathy with. And we say, if we can only sit this chap down and put him into a suit and a tie and a shirt and teach him table manners, which utensils to hold, the people will accept him. A magnificent example of this was the Elephant Man. And where we had this terrible deformity of the man, and yet beneath that ugliness was a terrific soul, a terrific man.
Maybe kids identify with monsters because, after all, isn't this what their parents are always saying to them? If you'd only get a haircut, learn to put your tie on and your jacket, eat like a decent human being, become civilized, and then you'll be accepted. And so the kids maybe sort of feel as if they're cast in the role of monsters and they identify strongly with this character that's being put down by everybody.
That could be, but my experience, our experience over 23 years has shown us otherwise. We found that the kids like them because the monsters are larger than life. And they have great strength, and they can smash down a door, and they can smash down a house, and they can pick up their teacher in their hand and say, stop aggravating me or I'll smash you on the pavement.
All the things they wish they could do.
All the things they wish they could do. It's why do we all wish we could be Superman? And of course, we're mere mortals. But the monster has superhuman strength and instant recognition, and although the monster may rampage through a town, I think the youngster identifies with that. I know I did.
One monster who loved to rampage was Godzilla. Japanese audiences were so delighted in seeing Tokyo destroyed that the city gets destroyed over and over again in most of the Japanese monster movies. In Japan, Godzilla proved a monster could break box office records by breaking the box office itself. These days, Godzilla has undergone a personality change. Instead of being a destroyer, he works for the forces of good. In his epic battle with the smog monster, Godzilla takes on a creature who lives and grows on the Earth's filth and pollution. We'll be back in a moment to see what other monsters of the movies are really made of. You can be assured that behind every movie monster, there's a man. And most of the time, there's a man inside the monster.
For example, here's a Japanese TV show in the making. Inside the rubber monster suit is a sweating actor who can hardly wait for the scene to be over. But the real monster is the director, who plans every movement the phony beast makes. Since the actor performs surrounded by miniatures of buildings and trees, he'll look gigantic when the film is completed. With some lion roars added, he'll sound horrendous too. Putting a man in a costume is the fastest way of getting a monster to the screen. But there's another way. And although it takes more time, it leads to some really fantastic creations.
Oh.
The Medusa in The Clash of the Titans was the work of Ray Harryhausen, who lives in England. You might call him an American monster maker in London. Ray Harryhausen has created some of the most memorable monsters in movie history.
So imaginative is his work and so skilled is its execution that the Museum of Modern Art in New York honored him this year with a special exhibition of some of his monstrous creations. That's where we are right now. We'll get back to this fellow in a moment. One of the interesting things you learn from this exhibit is that monsters that fill the screen with terror sometimes barely fill your hands. These hands belong to Jeff Roven, a science fiction and film writer who's done a book about Harryhausen. Jeff, how do Harryhausen's monsters work?
Well, these are basically ball and socket jointed models with each joint can bend and hold any position in which you place it. They're then covered with a latex foam, which looks like skin, and they're then painted. And as you see here, you move it roughly a millimeter, expose one frame of film, move it another millimeter, expose another frame, and continue that process until the film is projected and it looks as if you have a live monster on the screen. And of course, each of these heads has to be moved. You can average about a foot of film a day in this process. It's a meticulous, but very...
A foot of film a day? And how many feet of film to make a minute?
Well, it takes about a second for a foot to pass through the camera. So you're talking about a lot of work. Animating this Hydra took about a month and a half to create the entire sequence on the in Jason and the Argonauts.
These aren't just models then, Jeff?
No, these are the actual creatures you see in the finished film.
Including this fellow here?
Yes, this is the Kraken who appears at the climax of Clash of the Titans. It was the largest model that Ray Harryhausen ever built to give it a towering effect when it rose from the sea to menace Princess Andromeda.
In this entire world, there are only a handful of skilled artists and craftsmen who turn out monsters for the movies.
What we have here is nothing more or less than a monster factory. People come here to work in the morning at this industrial plant in North Hollywood. And what do they do all day? They make monsters. The chief monster maker here is a young man by the name of Rick Baker. Rick, where do all these creatures come from? Are these your nightmares come to life?
Not really. I don't really have nightmares. It's just my imagination, you know, a lot of daydreaming. And a lot of the stuff is based on real life people or animals or whatever, combinations of both.
You know? But can you explain what some of the folks are doing here?
Yeah, they're doing a little bit of everything. You know, it's, to make a monster, you really have to be an inventor, scientist, dentist, everything. You know, we make eyes, teeth, skin. Bones. It takes a lot, you know. And all these guys are all good at all that work, you know. We've got like Doug over here, who's our main machinist. He's making some mechanical hands, actually for this character now that I was sculpting. And we're making a skeleton basically, but it's out of metal, and we have tendons that we can manipulate and move the fingers just the way human anatomy works. Only in this case, we're using aluminum because of the weight. Bill here is making some mechanism to make the eyes blink on a mask. So it's, you know, we're not utilizing actors' eyes. We're utilizing artificial eyes. So to get that expression and life to it, he's making mechanical eyelids. And we've got Tom over here modeling some feet for this same character I'm working on his face here. So Tom's an excellent sculptor. Whipped out these feet in just the time that I've been working on this face here talking to you. And Sean's making some ugly monster over here of his own design, a little demonic character. Again, a lot of, this is where the real art comes into the work.
You really do have to be sculptors.
Oh, excellent sculptors, because we have to pass this stuff off as being real. You know, I mean, we're not, if it were an art piece, we could leave it at a rough stage, but we really can't do that when we get down to putting all the pores in and all the different textures and everything like that. Very time consuming, you know. Besides the actual sculpture in clay, sometimes we fabricate things directly out of polyurethane foam sheets and stuff like that, as Kevin's doing over here, fabricating a little test body for this character we're working on. You know, that eliminates the mold making process and all. It's a lot faster, only a little more crude. Steve is making some teeth, some dentures for his two-faced character that he designed here, pretty hideous mask. But, in this case, he has to make two sets of teeth, you know. Then my wife, Elaine, is our foam rubber technician. She runs all the foam latex and mixes the chemicals up for that, you know. And it's, we have to, like I said, do all kinds of crazy stuff. And I think I have a terrific crew. I think these are the best guys around. And I'm real proud of them.
Many of Rick Baker's creations were used in one of the most unforgettable scenes in motion pictures, the cantina sequence in Star Wars. Not only does Rick Baker make monster costumes and masks, sometimes he is the monster too. In the new version of King Kong, inside his own gorilla suit, was Baker himself. Baker's most recent film was An American Werewolf in London, where he again showed there can be art behind ugliness.
Rick, does it make any difference to you whether the head that you're making is for an actor to put on or whether it will operate without a man inside?
Oh, yeah, it makes a lot of difference in the design and everything else. But the main advantage to having an actor is that he acts and he gives a lot of life to the mask. And normally we wouldn't just have a mask for an actor. I mean, it would be a makeup, but I mean, it's amazing here what life an eye brings to a mask. You know, I mean, here you have a mask that looks like a mask, basically. It has no life to it. But if you put it on, and have eyes in it, and it really brings a different thing to it, you know.
Is it the eye itself that's either grotesque or beautiful, or is it what surrounds it that gives the character to the eye?
It's not just the eye as much as the lids and the area around it. I mean, you could, you know, really open them up wide and put your head back, you get a whole different look than, you know, real squinty and stuff, you know, so.
So it's not just that we're seeing your eyes, but we're also seeing your lids,
mm-hmm.
So that you can blink.
The whole area around the eyes.
All right.
The mask I just had on was a latex mask. There's no expression other than just the area around the eyes. When we want more facial movement, we go to a foam latex mask like this, which is glued to the actor's face with additional makeup applied. So when the actor moves his face, like so,
it moves with the face.
Exactly. But there's limitations to that in that you really can't, say, bare your teeth, for example. So in a case like that, we go to a mask with a mechanism in it, like this gorilla head over here. Now this head works while the actor's face, from the actor's movements, but it works a mechanism that actually makes a snarl, see? Let me see if I can put this on quickly here.
You do that with your mouth?
Uh-huh. With my jaw movements, actually. So that's a whole different type of thing. The material is the same, only now we have an understructure that's basically a skull. It has teeth and you know. And there's also a brow movement on this mask. Sometimes we'll have a mask that isn't a self-contained mechanism that's worked by someone off-camera, remote-controlled, that does a lot more expressions than we can fit in a mask like this.
What is the fun of it? Is it the idea of ultimately scaring somebody?
I'm fascinated by makeup and by this stuff because it's really like creating a life. You know, it's in a way, it's like being a god in that you're taking a piece of clay and you're making a face out of it, and then you're making that face move and be alive, and that's what really fascinates me. I don't know what everybody else's fascination with monsters are, but I think most people have even sort of a morbid curiosity about these things, you know. Monster movies, you can experience, you can safely experience terror, you know, and know that you're not really going to get hurt by it.
Rick Baker, another master monster maker. In a moment, we'll look for the origin of monsters back before the days of Dr. Jekyll and Dracula and Frankenstein and the Phantom of the Opera.
We are seeking man's first encounter with monsters, an encounter perhaps so frightening that its memory is permanently embedded in our genes to make us forever fearful and fascinated by mysterious and scary creatures.
Is it possible our monster story begins 100 million years ago? It was still the age of the dinosaur. These huge creatures, as portrayed in Fantasia, roamed the Earth by the thousands, some of them almost 90 feet long and weighing 35 tons. As some people in Hollywood have imagined it, the mere sight of them was enough to send waves of horror into the lives of early man. According to the film 1 Million Years B.C., the cave dwellers' battles with these monstrous dinosaurs was a battle for survival, not only for the caveman's place on Earth, but for his survival at the box office as well.
And then, for reasons still unknown, the dinosaurs who dominated the Earth for 150 million years suddenly vanished. No one even knew they ever existed until the mid-19th century, when their petrified bones began to show up. Later, those bones were brought for study to museums such as the American Museum of Natural History in New York, where we are now. These gigantic creatures captured our imaginations, and although our intellect told us that the dinosaurs were truly extinct, our imaginations kept saying that they were not really gone.
Searching his own imagination, Arthur Conan Doyle, the creator of Sherlock Holmes, let loose a dinosaur, which promptly trampled London. The movie version of The Lost World was a smash in every conceivable way. For a while, things were quiet on the dinosaur front, until Japanese filmmakers showed us that an atomic bomb set off in the ocean near Japan woke from a prehistoric sleep a fire-breathing, Tyrannosaurus-like monster with awesome power. They called him Godzilla and endowed him with very special effects. Maddened by being aroused a few eons too early, Godzilla took out his wrath on Tokyo. In electrifying scenes, those of us who went to the movies in 1956 can never forget. Did Godzilla have radioactive breath, but he proved to be the hottest monster in the history of the Japanese film industry, as popular an export as the Toyota.
And so it seems that the first monsters to have scared man must have been these fellows right here. And when you look closely at them, at their enormous size, those ferocious jaws and teeth, and when you think about their mysterious disappearance, well, it's easy to see why so many people think it just must be that the history of monsters began with these creatures. Right?
Wrong. Dinosaurs have nothing to do with monsters.
The expert who says dinosaurs have nothing to do with monsters is Daniel Cohen, who has written many books about monsters. In his attic office, we asked him if our notion of dragons and monsters was a genetic memory of dinosaurs.
You have to understand that the dinosaurs, as far as we know, were dead and gone, absolutely extinct, 65 to 70 million years ago. Now, there were no human beings or anything vaguely resembling human beings on the Earth at that time. Interestingly, when the dinosaurs were first discovered in the middle of the last century, the first images of them, the first reconstructions of them, made them look very, very much like the traditional dragon. The dragon was something that began with the Greeks and carried through the medieval times, and we knew about the dragon long before we knew about dinosaurs. I think that the dragon influenced the dinosaur rather than the dinosaur influencing the dragon.
What is a dragon?
A dragon, basically, in its origin, is a big snake. Greeks and the Romans, when they used the word dragon, what they meant was a very, very large snake, a python, a boa constrictor. These came in rather exaggerated tales, came from Africa and India via Greek and Roman travelers. And in the 13th, 14th century, the dragon began to pick up things that snakes don't have, like wings, a large head, and legs. Very often they were very tentative about giving it legs. Sometimes they first give it two legs, and then finally they would give it four legs, began to breathe fire, guard treasure, that sort of thing. But originally and initially, the dragon was a big snake, and that's all it was.
Of course, a traveler who had been someplace where nobody else had been, or at least that his listeners hadn't been, he could tell them anything he wanted.
Yeah, and usually he did. It happens today. In fact, if you look at the early stories about the gorilla as they came back, as they filtered back out of Africa, you had this monstrous creature, this chest-beating thing that would lurk up in trees and would reach down and would grab people and tear them to pieces, the whole image of, you know, of King Kong. Well, today we know that the gorilla is really a very peaceable, shy kind. It's kind of a creature. It's big, but I don't think it would be possible today to evoke the image of King Kong or murders in the Rue Morgue or these other gorilla monsters that were so popular earlier this century. A point I'd like to make is, you know, with the gorilla and with the, you know, many of the other creatures, there's a basis, there's a kernel of reality around which many of these fanciful stories were developed. Even with the dragon, you started with a real creature. I mean, you know, a 35 or 40 foot python, if you don't know what it is, that's a monster. The best example of that in modern times is what they call the Kraken, which was, you know, it was the greatest monster of the last century. This thing that looked like an uprooted tree with these great huge tentacles and these enormous eyes, and it would reach up on the deck of the ship and it would grab sailors out off the deck and it would stuff them down its beak, you know, it had a beak. What a crazy idea. I mean, absolutely, you know, that's clearly, the sailors have been out, they've been out at the sea too long, they've been drinking too much, but in fact, there is a real basis for reality for the Kraken. The Kraken was a giant squid, and nobody knew such a thing existed. Well, now we know that squids grow at least 60 feet from tip of tail to tip of tentacle, and maybe a lot more than that.
We know something about prehistoric man, pre-civilization. Did he know about dragons, or did he imagine them?
No, as far as we know, no one can tell what the cavemen thought, but we can look into their world through their art. And the art of the cavemen is very realistic. You look at the walls of the caves, they have the woolly mammoth and the bison, woolly rhinoceros, all very, very realistic kinds of drawings. There are no monsters in cavemen's art. It's only after you get into the civilized world, Egypt and Sumerians, that you begin to get these monstrous creatures like the jackal-headed god and the sphinx and all these other strange half-human, half-animal creatures. So I think that the idea of a monster is really the product of a civilized imagination. The caveman was a very practical sort of person. He put down what he saw. It's only after we had the leisure time to speculate on these things, and perhaps the width of experience to hear stories from other lands, that the idea of the monster really grew.
Since, as Daniel Cohen says, monsters are the products of our civilized imaginations, we can create any monster we like, from jolly green giants to jolly green dragons. When the Walt Disney Studios created Elliot, the jolly green dragon, in the film Pete's Dragon, they turned the tables on him and let the monster be scared for a change. Mickey Rooney and Red Buttons let Elliot see himself as others see him.
You're gonna see a hideous monster.
Oh, no.
Oh, yes. And it's big. 50 feet of terror.
Claws so sharp they could tear a man to shreds. Eyes, evil eyes that can see right through you. And a tail. Tail so big and powerful, it could destroy the hull of a frigate. Can wipe out an entire crew with one slice of his tail. Face so terrible, it could turn a man to stone. A hero into a coward. Flame so hot, it could roast a turkey, and a mouth so terrible, it could devour a man and spit him 20 leagues. Stay close.
Next, the monsters which might exist not in fiction, not in the movies, but in real life. Look out, there may be one who lives near you. We'll be right back. And now, we come to the most elusive and perhaps the most mysterious monsters of all. These, it is said, are the creatures which may indeed exist right now. Remote mountains and forests, and in the cold, deep waters of certain lakes and rivers. Creatures which are there one second and gone the next. Beings which have never been captured, except perhaps as some blurred image on a hastily focused film. Beasts which leave nothing behind but a dazzled eyewitness or a footprint in the ground. In the mountains of Tibet and Nepal may live one of the most famous, unclassified monsters of all, the Yeti. The abominable snowman of the Himalayas. He is supposed to be wild, hairy, and very smelly. If anything, he remains very invisible, except in one Hollywood feature film. There we get a look at the snowman's hand, and then a fast look at his face. The film is fiction, of course. A living Yeti has yet to sign with 20th Century Fox. Creatures like the Yeti have not only been reported in the Himalayas, they've been reported in North America as well. There are people who claim to have seen wild and hairy and very large, unexplained man-like monsters running free in the mountains and forests of the United States and Canada. Hundreds of years ago, the Indians of the Pacific Northwest called this apparition Sasquatch, or Wild Man. Today, it, or they, are commonly called Bigfoot. In 1967, a man by the name of Roger Patterson had been exploring the wilderness near Eureka, California, looking for Bigfoot. And at 3:30 in the afternoon of October 20th, Patterson and a companion spotted a strange figure in the woods. Patterson grabbed for his 16-millimeter movie camera. He shot first and talked later.
As I walked across the sandbar, I was able to get some fairly good footage of it. It turned a couple of times and looked at us. And as it turned, it seemed to give me the impression that it didn't want anything to do with us. It didn't run. It didn't act scared, but yet it acted leery of us.
This film and some footprints are the only physical evidence we have of Bigfoot. There are no bones and no remains of any kind. Experts who have seen this footage say it is not trick photography, but they can't say it's really a monster either. The search for Bigfoot still goes on. Last summer, about 60 miles from Lake Tahoe in California's El Dorado National Forest, the 1981 Bigfoot expedition was underway.
Sasquatch, you're there somewhere.
John Beckyord, the man who organized this expedition and who has devoted a substantial part of his life chasing every lead on this mysterious creature, has developed some interesting theories on the existence of Bigfoot. Why, after all these years, it has remained just beyond the firelight.
We're interested in finding out if there's any possibility that these animals, or creatures maybe, may be aliens of some kind living among us. Now, I'm not even sure what an alien is anymore. An alien doesn't necessarily have to come from Mars or Pluto or some other planet. It's very possible that they may have been living with us at all times in the past and the present, and that they just simply are living on a different life basis, chemical, physical life basis, than we are.
While the search for monsters who live on land continues, so does the search for monsters who live underwater. Here, in this beautiful lake in the highlands of Scotland, lives perhaps the most famous unclassified monster of all. Over 1,000 people have claimed to have seen the sea serpent, who is supposed to lurk in the murky depths of this mile-wide, 23-mile-long body of water called Loch Ness. And some of the people who have seen this unreal monster named Nessie have been unreal themselves.
Mr. Ashton! Mr. Ashton!
Holmes, I saw it. I saw it from the attic window. It's out there in the lake.
You saw what?
Telescope. Where's the telescope?
What did you see?
The monster.
The monster?
There. See it?
I see nothing.
Nothing? It's gone.
Gone? Maybe it was never there.
Holmes, I swear to you, I saw it as clear as anything.
Watson, as you so succinctly put it, we are living in the 19th century.
In the private life of Sherlock Holmes, the monster turns out to be a submarine. In real life, the most famous pictures of Nessie were taken by Tim Dinsdale in this blurry film of what's supposed to be the Loch Ness Monster cruising on the surface. Some people think this is an ancient reptile called a plesiosaurus, but there are other opinions too, as we shall soon find out. Then, of course, we Americans have our own water monsters. At least 26 lakes in the United States have reported sightings. Chesapeake Bay has its Chessie, and up in the Northeast, Lake Champlain has a monster called Champ. This is the widely published photo of Champ, taken by Sandra Mansi just this year.
This looks exactly like what we expect these animals should be like, if these are primitive whales.
To find out more about water monsters like Nessie, Chessie, and Champ, we went to the University of Chicago to meet Dr. Roy Mackel. He's a biologist who spent 5 years as the science advisor to one of the Loch Ness expeditions. Dr. Mackel says he saw the Loch Ness monster.
After 5 years, I was sitting in that front end of our workboat, and I saw the water begin to boil up, indicating the displacement of a large object about 30 feet to my right. My engineer was pulling up hydrophone cables because we had recorded the sounds of these creatures. And at that moment, I saw something rise out of that water, and it was a blackish back, much like a skin of a wet elephant, about 8 feet long in terms of the part that showed, twisting from left to right, and occasionally a triangular object to one side, perhaps 12 inches from the tip to the base, swung out. And in hindsight, I realized that was one of the flippers of the animal. But at that time, my reaction was, if this is a salmon, it is a mighty salmon indeed. After about a minute, it submerged without ever showing anything else.
And what have you concluded that that was?
We believe that our working hypothesis is that these are primitive whales related to animals known as zeuglodons, thought to be extinct on the basis of the fossil record for 20 million years. We think they're present in the ocean, rare, but still there, and occasionally reported as sea serpents. But every now and then they go upstream, rivers, feeding on the salmon as the females go upstream to spawn. They go up and feed for a while, and then they go back into the sea. We think that the animals in Champlain are exactly the same thing as in Loch Ness. They come in from the St. Lawrence Seaway, following the salmon, following the fish into this large reservoir.
Look out, he's still alive. Shoot!
The idea there still may be prehistoric animals alive somewhere on Earth has long fascinated movie makers as well as scientists. In a wild flight of Hollywood's fancy, animals long thought extinct were brought back in King Kong.
What do you call this thing? Why, something from the dinosaur family. A If I could only bring back one of these alive.
You are searching for a dinosaur, is that correct, in Africa?
Well, we're following up reports of a strange animal. We don't know what it is. We don't even know if they're there. We think they are on the basis of anecdotal evidence, which suggests to us that there's something to this, more than a myth or just a religious or cultural construction, because we penetrated a swamp where we had eyewitness observers, over 30, of different ethnic, religious, cultural, and geographical backgrounds, all describing the same thing to us. This suggests to us that there's a little fire behind this smoke.
Can you tell us where in Africa you're going and what you plan to do when you get there?
We're going back into the spot that we reached last time where we had eyewitness observers describe these animals to us. This is the center of a 30,000 square mile area of jungle swamp in the middle of the Congo Republic, about 1.5 degrees north latitude, just above the equator, between the Ubangi River and the Sanga River, which are tributaries of the Great Congo River.
But man doesn't get in there very much.
This has never been explored, even when it was a French colony, the one area that has never been thoroughly mapped.
Now, this creature, as described by eyewitnesses, does it look like some other creature that you know has existed in the past?
Yes, it looks like a small sauropod, that is, the animals that the brontosaurs belong to. Here's a model of the animal. As you see, the head neck is much thinner than the ordinary animals known as Brontosaurus or Diplodocus, and a long, thin tail. And this would be the size of a hippopotamus rather than large, 80 or 100 feet. This is a pretty good reproduction of what the pygmies described to us.
If Dr. Roy Mackel is correct in his assumption that a dinosaur still survives in the jungles of the Congo, then another monster legend will have disappeared in favor of a scientific explanation. But you can be sure that it won't take long before our minds are active again, finding new places for monsters to exist. After all, weren't there unexplained sounds heard coming back from Saturn? We'll be right back. We suppose that no matter how much we get to know about monsters, we will not easily give up our right to create them and then be scared out of our wits by our own creations. Today, the threat to us doesn't come from monsters. We, more than the monsters, are the ones who have mastery over the world. We keep the fictional monsters around because they fulfill some of our aggressive fantasies. And we keep searching for undiscovered monsters because we feel there's something romantic we don't know about. Something which hasn't been classified, stuffed, and put in some museum. When it comes to monsters, we want to believe, and we do believe, that there is something beyond the firelight, beyond the borders of reality, out there. I'm Charles Osgood. Good night.